The big emphasis on winter wheat right now, based on what we're seeing as far as feedback from producers and our own research trials, is that if there was a bottleneck or a barrier to adoption for those of you that haven't come over to the dark side of winter wheat yet and still cling to spring wheat, is that stand establishment is a big thing. And that really reinforces the idea that it has to be an integrative approach, probably even more so than spring wheat. And so a lot of the trials that you'll see, there's components that we're putting together, rarely in isolation, but usually together with multiple concepts, multiple factors, to see what systems, whether they're weak or strong, what the response is with what we develop. So for example, behind you there is a study. A big thing is alternative stubbles when you talk about stand establishment, because if you're getting into areas that are somewhat non-traditional or shorter season, this idea of cropping into canola stubble is fading each year with each new canola variety. There's, you know, increased yield potential, but that increased yield potential is less a function of real genetic potential in my mind, and more a reality of extending the growing season. If you add growing degree day units to any plant, you're going to increase yield potential. It's just whether or not that environment will support that, right? So what's happening in those areas then is guys are seeding those later maturing canola varieties, and we're getting into trouble sequencing behind canola. So behind you there is winter wheat planted onto barley stubble, for example. And what we're doing there is, so that's cereal on cereal, not always the greatest idea philosophy, but sometimes if that's all you've got to plant into, you plant into it and you deal with it and you manage it as best you can. One of the issues that you might run into is struggling with your nutrient management, because what can happen, depending on how much straw residue is there from a heavy barley crop, is you can get things like N immobilization and losing nitrogen to volunteers and that sort of thing. So a lot of what you see behind you is where we've removed all the barley straw, we've added lots back in, or we've added both straw and more grain in there to really stress that crop. And then we're managing the nitrogen. So there's a bunch of nitrogen applications within that as well. And so that's just year one of that one. And so there's really no results. For some of the ones that we're going to talk about, though, we have quite a bit of results, and some of it's even published because I think we're in year 12 now of working on some of our winter wheat stuff. So we've published a lot of information. If you're real keener and want to see those, I'll be happy to supply you with those as well. In terms of controlled release urea and winter wheat, how many guys are using controlled release ureas? So what are you using? ESN. Okay. Anybody using Agritain? Okay, so some of the stuff that we've published or about to publish, since there's a few guys out there. One thing with ESN that we have found is that, and I think even the folks at Agritain would sort of give that one up to ESN, is that there's nothing better for seed safety. If you want to put a lot of fertilizer down in the seed row, ESN is the way to go. And some of the stuff that we've reported now is you can go up to about 3 times the safe rate of urea with ESN, and you'd be just fine. Ross, I think, is even showing up to 4 times if conditions are conducive. But definitely 3 is a no-brainer with canola and cereals. So that's a good one. So the question is there a fit for ESN outside of a seed placement? And the answer is maybe, but the context of that changes a bit, because once you get outside seed safety as an issue, probably the best strategy with an ESN, whether or not you're top dressing later or you're banding beside the seed row, is cut that in half and blend it 50-50. We published a study a few years ago where we found no difference in yield potential with 100% ESN side-banded versus splitting that 50-50 with urea. So economically, once you get outside the seed row, it doesn't justify, in my mind, paying the full shot on ESN. Split it 50-50, and you'll be equally ahead money-wise. Well, further ahead, actually, because you've just cut your input costs down. One other really interesting thing that we're seeing with the Agritain products, probably superior when you're talking about a split application with winter wheat. So you're putting some down at seeding, then you're going back in the spring. We've also studied that application going on later in the fall. Do not do that. Other researchers have reported that as bad, and we found the same thing. Guys are tempted to do that because of how wet it is in the spring in some areas of the prairies. So what we've shown, particularly with things like ESN, urea ammonium nitrate, those just do not work well in the fall. And urea is not much better either. So one that didn't look too bad in the fall was super urea, which isn't available yet. Earl Greeno's here with Agritain. He can tell you more about where and when that might come into the Canadian marketplace, but that one's looking pretty good. And frankly, so is Agritain. It looked really good in terms of both yield potential on a split application and in terms of nitrogen recovery. Because one thing with these controlled release ureas is you may not always see that economic benefit, but chances are there's a longer term benefit with going with those in terms of nitrogen recovery, efficiency, and the prevention of losses. Because quite often, and much to the chagrin of Agritain, Agrium, and all those guys, regular urea a lot of times does just fine. And so, you know, there still is a very good fit with these controlled release products in my mind versus straight urea. So the next experiment to talk about here is this one in the background. You see some spring wheat and some winter wheat, and this actually came after the DIAP projects, and one of the gaps in research that we thought we had was in relation to fusarium management. Obviously for growers more outside this zone, but this is becoming an interesting study for us here as well, just because of the amount of leaf disease we're seeing. The question here is, what role does genetics play in that versus cultural practices? So again, it's back to this agronomic system. Do not believe that your variety is going to be the be-all end-all regardless of what you hear. You can make an old variety look really good with a strong agronomic system, and you can make a brand new variety look absolutely horrible with a poor agronomic system, irrespective of crop. And so this is a nice study where we're combining both. We've got both weak and strong cultivars in here in terms of resistance to fusarium, and then we're either running that in the fall with no seed treatment, or we're putting down a seed treatment, the Cruiser Max for cereals, or we're not doing that and we're just coming in the spring and putting down Bayer's Procero. And then the last treatment is we just combine it all together to see what the differences are. And so this again is year one. We won't have too many results for you until later this fall. But if you want to walk with me, we'll talk a little bit about some of these other experiments. So when you look at your spring wheat plots and you try to point out to me how much better they look, well, it's because these guys are missing a row. Ken and company had an issue with their seeder last fall, and so all of the winter wheat plots are missing a row. So if you're seeing a major gap all the way along, that's the explanation for that. There's going to be little pockets of holes in some of these, and that's where we're doing plant stand counts and all that kind of stuff. So just some background. Another kind of interesting thing you'll see as we get further down is there's the odd spot here and there where we've got white heads, and that is probably a function of some soil-borne disease that we're dealing with, particularly over there. This is all on barley stubble, and my guess is we've got something like take-all or some other kind of root rot that's just in isolated pockets that's stressing the winter wheat out a little bit. But anyway, this variety here is Emerson, developed by Ag Canada here at Lethbridge under the guidance of Dr. Rob Graff, and this is a real positive breakthrough for the Manitoba growers because they are in dire need of a winter wheat that's got good fusarium tolerance. And so this is our strong cultivar, and you can see the different treatments. Visually, I'm not seeing a whole lot in terms of differences between the control and either the seed treatment or the foliar, but that can be a little bit deceiving. We've got lots of data on in-crop foliars and seed treatments in winter wheat, and visually you may not see something, but I was very surprised at the end of the year when we did do up our yield results, and we definitely saw significant results by using seed treatments as opposed to not to, and we'll end the discussion with that study. So further down we go. Falcon, of course, would be our weak variety for winter wheat. So two comments here, just for those that aren't growing winter wheat. I've also looked a lot at seeding rates, as you may or may not know, both in spring and winter wheat. And I just published one that had both durum and hard red spring wheat in it. And the surprising thing, even with spring wheat, is that there was a linear positive response to increase seeding rates through 450 seeds per meter squared, which is actually the rate that I recommend for winter wheat. One thing to remember, as we increase our genetic gain, our genetic potential with any crop, there's probably going to be a response to seeding rates, just like there was back in the old days when corn shifted to hybrids. And there was no result, positive result in yield of hybrids versus conventionals until they started pushing seeding rates. And that same philosophy applies to both spring and winter wheat. I use CDC Go in an older durum variety called AC Avonlea. And AC Avonlea with both actually, a little bit higher yield potential than most, right through to 450, I was getting good results. And those trials were at Colehurst, which is typically a pretty dry site for us, and then out at Nobleford on Brian Buckman's farm. So that's a bit of advice when we talk about seeding rates for both spring and winter wheat. And the other reason why we like winter wheat this time of year is, as you can see, the tap for the most part has been shut off, but we're in a pretty vulnerable stage with our spring wheats. And so the question will be whether or not these guys will get enough moisture to properly fill versus the winter wheat, which is well on its way to completion.
I've noticed on the Carberry, it's about 2 weeks earlier than Lillian.
Maybe a little more. I don't know about 2 weeks, but it might be a bit earlier. Yeah, and that's probably speaks to why it is good in terms of fusarium tolerance. Winter wheat generally, not exclusively, but one of the overall traits versus spring wheat is that it can escape fusarium because that flowering period ends before those spores are going wild. And that partially would probably explain Carberry. Not completely, but partially. But 2 weeks over Lillian.
And Lillian was seeded 3 hours before that too.
3 hours? Shit, you know your timing. Yes?
The crop's flowering right now. Is it too late to be spraying a fungicide for fusarium head blight?
You're on the later side. And I'm glad you brought that up because I meant to speak to that. We had a lot of questions this year on when should I use a foliar and when I shouldn't. The label instructions apply, but the question is, there were a lot of guys throwing it in with their herbicide. And the idea of a tank mix of a herbicide and a foliar makes great sense logistically. I want to get through that field once and be done with it when I'm ready to spray my weeds. But the thought of early timing of weed removal coinciding with the appropriate stage to apply in terms of disease management, I just don't think that can ever reconcile itself. I mean, we're in a better position today than we ever were to get over that field fast with a sprayer. So, and there was a good example of that. The one thing you got to remember, if you're spraying, it's because your crop is diseased, right? Do not do it prophylactically. So if you start seeing that leaf one down from the flag, the penultimate leaf, starting to build up with some lesions, that's probably a good time to start thinking about it. But there were guys that had no lesions on that penultimate leaf. They were going in and throwing it in the herbicide tank and just thought, well, what harm would it do? And the fact is, I mean, a lot of, you know, fungicides are kind of like chemotherapy for plants, right? As humans, we take chemotherapy if we're very sick. We generally, after we're sick, sometimes get quite well, but you know, you get very sick in the process. And so you have to look at it the same way when you're applying those fungicides to crops in that way. So be very careful about when you apply and why you're applying, because prophylactically is a big waste of money, more so than herbicides. But you know, if it gets into the flag, that's not necessarily, you know, gonna hurt your yield potential either. If it goes into the flag late, you know, like there, you know, you gotta think about economic thresholds and when it's right to apply. And if, you know, if it goes in late, just like if stripe rust goes in late, you know, the economic threshold probably isn't there like it would be if it moves in really early. So it's not the end of the world if your flag's got some. The yields here actually weren't that bad, and it was completely loaded with striped rust last year, this particular experiment.
You're saying that you looked at the second leaf just before the flag leaf?
Yeah, that's the one you want to be watching in my mind. Anything underneath that, if you're getting senescence, early senescence, but those two leaves there are maintaining. I mean, those are the two that represent the most in terms of your photosynthetic machine and your yield potential. And those are the ones we want to try and keep clean, particularly the flag. But the one under that's a good one to watch, because if it starts getting up there, I mean, it might. So by the time you get out there, right, that would probably be a good time to spray. So changing things up a little bit, what we've got here are two experiments of brome. The Alberta Winter Wheat producers, when they signed on, one thing they really wanted from their producers was more work done on brome management. Japanese brome, relatively new in terms of a pest for winter wheat, but in terms of downy brome, not new at all. And pre-seed burn downs did a lot to control that, but there's still some issues with that because you're dealing with a winter annual competing with a winter annual. And so what we've got here is we looked at several chemistries last year. Simplicity is obviously the one everyone's probably most familiar with in terms of controlling brome in winter wheat. We also looked at Everest and Velocity, and then we either applied that in the spring, or one idea we had is let's try and apply it in the fall, just in terms of spreading workloads and seeing what kind of efficacy you get in the fall. The fall, for the most part, wasn't bad. We did get some injury with Everest in the fall. But overall, it was generally Everest in the spring, Simplicity in the spring. You know, we sort of had pretty decent suppression-like results with those two. We used Falcon because it's shorter and we wanted a weak variety, and we also planted it at a little bit lower seeding rate of 300 seeds per meter squared because we wanted to really stress it a bit. And so the results were okay, but one, Eric Johnson out of Scott, Saskatchewan, and I are heading up this study. And one thing that was exciting is he came across a new chemistry actually that's being used in Australia, the US, and in Eastern Canada for corn and soybeans mainly. And one of them is pyroxysulfone. And so he was interested to see what that would be like in terms of brome management. That one is applied at seeding or just prior to seeding. So it's got some soil residual activity. And the results are actually pretty good. If you see the ones that have pyroxysulfone on here, they're looking generally a lot better than anything else. So that's pretty exciting. It'll just be a question of how well those efficacy results are versus any phytotoxicity we might observe with that. And so two exciting things there is a new chemistry, which speaks to weed resistance, and the other one is just a good new herbicide potentially for brome management for winter wheat growers. So again, it's registered as a tank mix with flumioxazin down in Eastern Canada for corn and soybeans. Soybeans in the US, but Australia through Bayer, I believe, has it in for wheat and triticale. So if we can show some efficacy and some good results with it, who knows, we might be able to get that into Western Canada as well. So that's something we're pretty hopeful on, but this is year one, and so far, this far into it, it's looking pretty good.
Is it a different group?
It's a group. Those two are group 14 and 15. So that's pretty important.
Does it do any other grasses?
I'm not sure. I don't even know that it was really listed to control brome, so I would say yeah. Yeah.
What about Vara? Did you try that this year?
Sorry?
Bear's got a new one. I think it's called Vara.
No. The only chemistries we had in here were the ones I mentioned, like the Velocity, Everest, Simplicity. Yeah. So there is a new version of Velocity. If you see the sign here, it says Velocity 2.0. There's a newer version of Velocity. That could be what you're talking about, actually. So. Yeah. No, it's Velocity, isn't it?
Velocity all-in-one.
Oh, okay.
Everest has a new version, too. It's 2.0.
Oh, is it? Oh.
What about, did you talk
What was the fertility on here? Did we put it all down at seeding?
Yeah.
Okay, let's carry on. So this is kind of a cool experiment. I started off talking about winter wheat on barley, and one of the things that we wanted to look at was how do we manage volunteer barley when we've planted into barley stubble with winter wheat? And so year one of this experiment, CDC Butea was planted and it basically outcompeted barley to where there was no barley. So we knew at that point, we can probably stop that experiment right there. And so we readjusted it, knowing that we had this new chemistry of pyroxysulfone. But one thing I was interested in was, okay, let's think of it differently in terms of stand establishment again. And coming into the spring, if you've planted onto barley stubble or something else, and you have a poor stand because of winter kill or some other reason. And so what we've done is we've altered the plant population. So this one is seeded low at 150 seeds per meter squared. And you can see it looks like it. And this one's seeded heavy at, or at a moderate, I guess I would say, 450 seeds per meter squared. So you get a good sense of the strength of an agronomic system, just speaking in terms of seeding rates. 200 to 250, that was a pretty common seeding rate for winter wheat not that long ago. In fact, I still hear it sometimes. Makes me shudder. But anyway, this is pyroxysulfone at a lower dose. We've got some dose in here up to quite high. The 112? Is it the 112? The 112 is the rate that's at in that tank mix with flumioxazin. So 112 to 150 is what we're seeing. I think we've got one that's higher at like 200 that caused some crop injury. So, but anyway, that weak and strong system in combination with these herbicides to manage weeds in general is what this is all about now. And we've underseeded it with wild oats and cleavers. So you can judge for yourself if you find any cleavers, wild oats, depending on what the treatment is. So take a look around. I'll meet you at the end of the range. How many guys here used Simplicity this year? How did you find the results? Yeah, I mean, we've got Simplicity in this trial as well, and this year versus last year, not seeing as good a results with Simplicity for us anyway. And last year, I know there were some efficacy issues just because of the horrible conditions we had, but anyway.
I think it worked really good because we did a post-seeding.
Oh, yeah?
Spraying Roundup on it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Before we move over to the next experiment, just a comment. We won't walk over there in the interest of time, but the experiment behind me diagonally, that's one where we're looking at all the alternative stubbles. So we're looking at everything from just regular barley canola stubbles, adding straw in, removing straw, adding grain in without any grain. One interesting one result that we're seeing there though is we added camelina in because there was a lot of hype around camelina as a potential new oil seed for a bioindustrial end use. And so we had it actually seeded in the fall plus in the spring. And one thing that we've known and that we would not recommend based on what we're seeing there is sequencing winter wheat behind spring planted camelina because that was not a good thing. The amount of volunteer in there from the camelina, you could tell it was just stealing away all the nitrogen on the winter wheat. So it was quite an interesting visual there. So anyway, we'll have more results on that experiment next year in terms of sequencing. So now what we'll do is we'll head over a few ranges and start heading back. Just a quick comment on these two experiments behind me. What we're also doing as part of this project is integrated nutrient management. There's a summary of some of the work that we've done on controlled release ureas. If you're interested, I can share that with you. The other thing we're doing is we're getting close in terms of precision farming to start integrating tools like a Green Seeker, which is an optical sensor that will tell your unit how much to put down in terms of a foliar in-crop application of nitrogen. And so the problem though, that's a tool developed in the States, primarily an evolution and application for corn. So the algorithm that's used is not an algorithm that would necessarily apply to conditions in Canada. So Guy Lafond out of Indian Head is heading up this, where you see FPR on these tags, that's a farmer practice rate. And so we're mimicking farmer practice rates or a proportion of that in either all at seeding or a split application. And then we're comparing that to where you see GS, which is Green Seeker. And that's basically what that US algorithm has told the Green Seeker to put down in terms of nitrogen. And so we'll compare those and rejig that algorithm so that it's applicable to Western Canada, so that when that tool is attractive and you know, ready for sort of widespread adoption, it's also ready for winter wheat growers. The other one as part of that study is, in terms of a good algorithm, you need a good sense of where your yield potential is with winter wheat. And so there's five varieties as we walk down by five side-banded rates of nitrogen, 0 to 120 kilograms per hectare. 120 is generally where you need to be at with winter wheat, anywhere from that to 150, even higher to 170. So those higher rates are the ones to be looking at in terms of how they look. And we've got anywhere from general purpose type varieties to the newer milling types as well. So just have a look, head down, and I'll meet you at the next series of experiments. Last two experiments, which I think are probably the coolest of the experiments that we have out here. And the question was, would seed treatments, primarily would seed treatments affect stand establishment at all? Or would that translate into a yield boost versus not using them? And so we have two experiments here. This one here is a complete array of agronomic systems from very weak to very strong. And it involves three components. One is seeding rate. So we have a low seeding rate here of 200 seeds. It involves seed vigor. And so how we achieved that was we took a seed lot of CDC Buteo and scalped it and took the thins and the plumps and called that light and heavy. And then the regular lot was our medium. And so we've got light, moderate, and heavy seed in here. So if you want to talk about a weak system, then you'd have a low plant population, poor seed lot, and then potentially not using any seed treatment. And so that's what this plot is here. So where you really see a difference and an advantage with a seed treatment is in a weak system like that. So if you look at this plot here, it's the same plot, except we've added a seed treatment at seeding. And this isn't just a 1 year off thing. We've got 8 site years from last year where we saw this as well. And that, as you can see, produced a significant yield advantage over a system like that. So the next question is, well, what if I have a strong agronomic system to begin with? And so the plots behind you there with that flag are at 400 seeds per meter squared and may or may not have the seed treatment. And so the question there is, well, do I need it when I have a strong agronomic system? And the question is, maybe not, but I think what we found with all of our treatments was that they paid for themselves in terms of the net return. And so I guess I would look, if I'm confident I've got a strong agronomic system, I would look at, you know, an insurance policy, because it's sort of a hindsight thing. You don't know how strong your system of winter wheat is until you assess it in the spring usually. And so the seed treatments in my mind are a very good insurance policy with our winter wheat crop. And so this is Raxel WW, so it's a combination of an insecticide and two fungicides. Any questions on that? Yeah.
Do you know off the top of your head what the seed conversion is to bushels per acre? Like you said, 400 seeds per meter squared.
Well, it's going to fluctuate with kernel weight, right? And so that's why we want guys thinking in terms of density, spatial densities. But generally, 450 would be around 2 to 2.25 bushels per acre. So as we end, you can walk that way, and the experiment here also involves applying a fungicide in the fall. And the question there was, would we have any effect by, instead of looking at application of Proline in the spring, let's just put our fungicide in the fall and see what happens. And what happened was, where we had stripe rust confirmed, and that was at 3 sites last year, we significantly improved our grain yield by applying our our foliar in the fall versus not using a foliar. And so what I would suggest, if you're an industry rep, crop consultant, if you see stripe rust in the fall, I think those results are pretty compelling, if the conditions are right, to get producers to apply then, because definitely you'll have a return that will be positive in terms of yield, because you may or may not get back out there in the spring at the right time for that to work, or to even have the conditions that would allow that fungicide to be efficacious. All right, so I will meet you at the end. If you have any questions, feel free to holler.